From the time I was a little kid, I wanted to study primates. There are pictures of me as a little kid with monkey stuffed animals. I was really, really, really shy. I didn't really want to be around people too much. I do remember loving National Geographic and reading about Jane Goodall. Any kind of like primate that was involved, I was really attracted to that. I'm Stacey Tecot. I am an associate professor at the University of Arizona in the School of Anthropology, and I'm a biological anthropologist. These are really old. It's from 2004. I specialize in primatology. Primatology is the study of primates, and so that includes humans, other apes, monkeys, and a group called strepsirrhines that includes lemurs and lorises and little primate animals like that. The species that I study most of the time, they're really closely bonded, they have zero aggression, they just do what he's doing all the time, they're all huddled up, and I really enjoy watching lemurs. My dream had always been to work with wild primates. 2000, that was my first trip to Madagascar. We left the capital really early in the morning. I think we might have gotten a flat tire, I can't even remember. About 12 hours or so, we ended up at the park entrance. And we were just dropped off with all of our stuff. It was just pitch black, and I didn't know where I was. Then went to sleep, and I woke up in the morning and just saw that I was in the middle of this amazing rainforest. And I just fell in love. And I fell in love with people I was working with too. You just have really meaningful connections. And it made me realize I didn't just want to be isolated in the middle of a forest without anybody. But I really did like being isolated with this great team that I worked with. I get to escape the rush. Living life in tune with the environment and go into the field and just be in the forest. In Madagascar, there's been a history of habitat disturbance. In the 1980s, there was a logging concession. Large fruit-bearing trees were extracted, and the forest has been recovering. So that's considered secondary forest. In that secondary forest, 1 month you might have pretty good fruit availability, which is red-bellied lemur's favorite food. The next month you might have nothing. The habitat disturbance allows me to ask questions about factors like us going in and changing a habitat will impact their behavior and their physiology and their ability to survive and reproduce. Not just in primatology, but in a lot of fields where foreigners come in and do research. They do their work, they don't talk to people, they decide what they're going to do, and they take the information away from them. Just because we may be trained in different ways in the Western world doesn't mean that that knowledge should be privileged. It's really imperative for primatologists in particular to look at what limitations there are to the survival of these species and figure out what we can do to work with local communities and contribute in some way. In my case, asking what kinds of questions need to be asked from their perspective, incorporating the knowledge that they have, thinking of ways to work together. The work that I do in the field is impossible to do alone. I would probably still be lost in the middle of the forest if it weren't for my team that I work with. The first time I went to Madagascar, I was paired up with Telu Albert. He's just this amazing wildlife expert, who is now also the Apanzak, or the king of his village. And he's still working as a research technician who helps the foreign researchers that come in. One of my field sites, we're in the middle of the forest and we live in tents. We cook out there, it brings water up from the river, and it's pretty rugged. And we wake up really early in the morning and then we set out looking for the lemurs. We use our forest eyes and forest ears, start to be able to see, smell, and hear things that when you first come in the forest, you just aren't aware of. We don't use any kind of tracking system. We just know where their groups hang out. Lemurs tend to look like big balls of moss in the trees. And once we find red-bellied lemurs, we watch them. And every time they poop, we get it. We know who it came from, and it's not mixed in with another individual's poop. We carefully collect that sample. Same thing with urine. I had a whole field season devoted to figuring out how to collect urine in the rainforest from an arboreal species. They live in the trees. Very high up. Hormones that we want from those samples are very sensitive. The sample has to be frozen and kept frozen right after we collect it till it gets back into the lab in the United States. And with the fecal samples, we dry our samples in the field and we grind them up with a mortar and pestle, and then they're analyzed back in the lab. From the fecal samples, we can measure hormones like cortisol. It's considered an indicator of the stress response. So by looking at these patterns, we can see what kind of strategies they're using to get through a difficult situation. That research, it's evolved into looking at the evolution of owl maternal care. the majority of species have some kind of allomaternal care, where dads or female relatives, male relatives, totally unrelated individuals will help in some way care for infants. One of the questions that I'm focused on is why allomaternal care occurs at such high frequency in primates, how it evolved, and what are the mechanisms promoting that kind of behavior. We're looking at how much this occurs, who does it, when they do it, why they do it, and the main part of this research is looking at the hormonal changes that are associated with allomaternal care. Humans have a lot of allomaternal care. Sometimes hormonal changes occur in partners when their partner is pregnant. And there are some hormonal changes that are associated with care. To really understand how that occurs and why that occurs, we have to look at a species where it's variable. When I was watching red-bellied lemurs, I noticed that not just the moms were taking care of the babies. Sometimes dads would help, sometimes siblings would help. What we found is that when their partners are pregnant, the dad's hormones are changing too. And then once the babies are born, we see changes in their androgen levels, and androgens are hormones that include testosterone. With protective behaviors, their androgen levels are elevated for short periods of time. With the nurturing behaviors, their androgen levels are lower for a short period of time. It's important to understand what kind of flexibility they have. Behavioral flexibility is going to be the way that they're able to hopefully respond to really fast changes, like what's happening with climate change. Reproduction is timed with food. And so if you're changing when food is available, you have to change when you're reproducing. They're not able to be flexible when they have babies. When they go outside of that strict seasonal breeding, their infants all die. 100% of them outside of their season, they all die. It's really important to me that my research is non-invasive. We don't touch the animals at all. We don't capture them to put collars on them to identify them. When you have different people cycling into a project, it's really helpful to know that everyone knows the individual you're looking at is who you think you're looking at. We've developed this algorithm. So at the moment, we can take these pictures, put them into the computer, and it can tell us the top five matches. Eventually, what we really hope is that maybe this could help with wildlife crime enforcement. And so if individuals are plucked from their homes for illegal exportation, then you can maybe find where they originated from. There are over 500 primate species in the world, over 60% are threatened with extinction. Lemurs are the most threatened large group of mammals out there. Almost all lemur species are threatened with extinction. There's this really long time coming shift in working with people. A lot of primatologists are realizing that people in those countries where they work have really important knowledge. We have to learn how to work together to promote the conservation of these species. Also helping people in those places figure out how they can survive. It's past the time where we should have been focusing on these things.